The story of how humans treated malaria represents one of our greatest achievements. What used to be one of the deadliest diseases in the world has been studied, netted, drained, and medicated out of entire countries. Even in the last 20 years, we've cut the number of malaria cases in half and reduced the disease's death rate among children. The disease is still a big deal though, with hundreds of thousands of cases around the world, most of which are children in sub-Saharan Africa. But different organizations have targeted malaria for eradication. They think we can get rid of it. And what I find fascinating about this story is how it was a slow build. Experts have been building a strategy against malaria over the last 200 years using chemistry and entomology and public health and a recently developed vaccine. It was this series of clues and observations and trials that got us to the point where one of the most serious diseases is almost at the point where we think we can get rid of it. This is the story of how humans beat malaria. Almost. What's up, everyone? If you're new here, my name is Patrick. Thanks for joining us. I hope you're doing well. So what I find so fascinating about this story is how it's not just one story. It's multiple overlapping stories. We had to learn the biology and pathology of malaria to treat individuals, but we also had to learn how to apply that knowledge to huge groups of people. So before we go any further, I want to introduce you to Susanna. She's getting her PhD in global health, and she's going to explain the public health and policy side of things throughout this video. You ready, Susanna?
Let's do this.
You get that was stitched together. Yeah, you get it. We've been documenting a disease presumed to be malaria for thousands of years. Everyone from ancient Chinese, Indian, Egyptian, and Greek civilizations described a disease we think was malaria. I mean, they didn't call it malaria, but they did describe symptoms that match up with our modern understanding of the disease. So when historians read medical documents from back then, whether it's on paper, scrolls, clay tablets, or whatever, they're looking for descriptions of things like enlarged spleen with headaches and the chills. But the biggest clue is the pattern of fever. One of the classic symptoms of malaria is a fever that shows up every third day or every fourth day. And then there's where they found the reported cases. Stagnant water. In fact, the modern name, malaria, translates to bad air, like the thick, humid air around the swamps that provided the breeding ground for the disease. And all of these groups had their own treatments for it, but the story of the modern treatment of malaria usually starts with the COLUMBIAN exchange.
COLUMBIAN exchange is the widespread exchange of plants, animals, and diseases between the Eastern and Western hemispheres from around the 1400s to the 1500s. Now, with European expansion and colonization, they brought over diseases like tuberculosis and smallpox to indigenous lands. This contributed to the severe reduction of the Native American population. But let's not forget that Native Americans are still here and they are experts in our planet, and we have so much to learn from them. In tropical regions, Europeans were exposed to diseases like malaria. This is a primary reason why they would stay along the coast of Africa rather than moving inward. When they did try to move inward, a large number of them would die. In the first year of settlement along the Gold Coast of West Africa in the early 1800s, they found that out of 1,000 Europeans, 300 to 700 of them would die. This is how the Gold Coast of West Africa got the name White Man's Grave.
So the Europeans wanted a malaria treatment. Fast forward to the 1600s when Spanish missionaries came to South America. Indigenous people showed the missionaries this tree, what Carl Linnaeus would later call the cinchona tree. There are a few origin stories for how cinchona was first used in medicine. One says that a sick man was cured by drinking water that had been contaminated by the tree. Another said that a princess's illness was cured by eating the bark from the tree. So with this reputation for curing headaches and fevers, cinchona was brought back to Spain. But you wouldn't just gnaw on a piece of bark. If you wanted to take it as medicine, usually you'd dry the bark, grind it into a powder, then mix it in some wine and take a swig. That cinchona bark was effective because it had a compound in it called quinine. Quinine, if you pronounce it the UK way. So in 1820, a couple of chemists crushed up some of the bark and isolated quinine itself, and that was a big deal. In this case, quinine is what's called the active ingredient, the thing in a medicine that has a biological effect on the body. Right, this bark is still just a chunk off of a tree. Obviously, there are multiple chemicals that make it up. And when it comes to designing a malaria treatment, we only cared about quinine since that was the compound that had the anti-malarial effect. By isolating the active ingredient, we could do some of the first clinical drug trials in history. And these trials ask two questions. First, is it safe? And second, what's the best dosage between too much and too little?
Once they found out that quinine was an effective treatment, Europeans raced to extract cinchona bark from indigenous lands and use this new treatment to move inwards into Africa. For perspective, let's go back to 1841, when Europeans went on a missionary expedition up the Niger River. On this expedition, there were 150 Europeans and 150 Africans. Of those 150 Europeans, 42 of them died. Of the 150 Africans, none of them died. Europeans saw that they were more vulnerable to tropical diseases than Africans, and they actually used this as a justification for why Africans were more fit to do labor, and actually used this to justify the transatlantic slave trade. A few years later, in 1854, Europeans made another expedition up the Niger River, but this time they had quinine. Quinine was so effective in treating fevers that historians believe it contributed to the great reduction in European deaths. For example, in French Senegal, the French military's death rate dropped by 66% between 1819 and 1851. Now, all this time, we're studying the effects of cinchona bark and quinine, yet we don't really have an idea of where the disease comes from or how it even starts.
But at this point in the story, we're starting to transition from miasma theory to germ theory. And I know I mention germ theory all the time, but that's because it was such a big deal in managing infectious diseases like malaria. There were four main ideas in germ theory, one of which said that we had to find the germ that causes disease, isolate it, and grow it in the lab so that we can use it in experiments. So how did we find the germ that causes malaria? This military doctor, Alphonse Laveran, was stationed out in Algeria. He studied bodies that had died from malaria. He would look at blood samples under a microscope and notice these dark pigments on red blood cells and wiggly tails, or flagella. That gave him the idea that he was looking for a parasite. And as he analyzed the blood, he kept finding the same parasite. His discovery took a little while to gain steam, but by 1884, the scientific community was on board with the idea that malaria was caused by this little parasite. Well, sort of. It's not just that one parasite, and scientists would later find out that there wasn't just one version of malaria either. In the 1890s, scientists had described two forms of malaria. One with a 3-day pattern of fever, one with a 4-day pattern of fever. They thought that two different parasites caused the two patterns of fever. And they were right. It's not just one species of parasite that causes malaria. It's five species from the genus Plasmodium. They were able to use this to come up with an improved dosage timing for quinine, but also to learn more about the parasite's life cycle. When an infected mosquito bites you, it injects a form of the parasite called a sporozoite, which heads to the liver. They reproduce and turn into their next form, merozoites. It's this form that invades our red blood cells. Then they multiply again, burst out, invade more red blood cells, and repeat. That's what causes disease, these parasites and red blood cells. Some of those merozoites turn into gametocytes and circulate in the blood, eventually to be taken up by a mosquito, where they mature and produce a little offspring that becomes a new sporozoite. Those offspring migrate to the mosquito's salivary gland, where they can be passed on to humans the next time the mosquito feeds. We know the whole life cycle today, but back in the late 1800s, they only knew this part. They suspected that mosquitoes were involved, but they hadn't shown it yet. This concept of vector-borne diseases, or diseases carried by one organism and given to another, was brand new for the time. A British military officer and a group of Italians proved that mosquitoes could transmit the bird version of malaria, and soon afterwards found the human version. But it had to be the right kind of mosquito, specifically a female Anopheles mosquito. And this was a big discovery, not just for malaria, but now doctors could say disease can be spread through animals now, not just coughing and cholera water, which means now we have a treatment for people who are already sick, and as long as we can prevent mosquito bites, we should be able to prevent malaria.
Concentrating on prevention means taking proactive steps towards preventing the disease. Malaria is a vector-borne disease, so global health scientists knew that we needed to control the vector to prevent malaria. There are two main interventions for vector control. The first intervention is called insecticide-treated nets, or ITNs, or what's also known as mosquito nets. This is a fine meshy type of material that you can hang over your sleeping area so that you can prevent yourself from getting bit by those pesky little biters while you sleep. Organizations or governments supplied with mosquito nets can distribute them to local communities and educate the people on how to use them. The second intervention is called indoor residual spraying, or IRS. This spraying technique coats the walls of homes with an insecticide that kills the mosquito once they have fed on it from landing on the wall. There are a bunch of different types of insecticides that can be used, but unfortunately, some mosquitoes have grown resistant to some of them. There are also behavioral changes that people can do to reduce their risk of getting bit by a mosquito. Mosquitoes are pretty active during dawn and dusk, and so having people stay indoors during those times can reduce their risk of getting malaria. People also may have watering cans or buckets of water sitting outside their home. Mosquitoes love standing water, and so providing these folks with lids to put over their watering cans or buckets of water can really help reduce the risk of mosquitoes from making babies. But to use these strategies, it comes with certain privileges. If there's no drainage infrastructure in the city, then there's just gonna be a bunch of standing water during monsoon seasons. Some impoverished communities may have mosquito nets, but choose to use them as fishing nets instead because their economy is suffering.
So while we worked on prevention strategies, we also got some new drug options. Some of them, like methylene blue, turned your skin blue, or mepocrine turned your eyes yellow. Quinine had side effects as well, but a new antimalarial made in the lab would become way more important. That drug was chloroquine, which is still in use today. And we're skipping over the other pharma developments and some of the drug resistance talk because I want to get to the part of the story where we implemented these practices.
In the 1950s, the World Health Organization saw the success so far with malaria, and they got the idea that maybe we can eradicate the disease worldwide. It was ultimately a little too ambitious for them, and they called it off in the 70s. While you may have heard of many folks who have recovered from malaria, the crude death rate is 40 per 100,000. Side note, what is crude death rate? Crude death rate, or CDR, is a number of deaths within a given time period over the average population within that same time period. We use CDR because it gives us an idea of how diseases are affecting populations within that year, and it can help inform health authorities to make decisions based on that data. As of 2016, malaria is the sixth leading cause of death among low-income countries. The disease is especially harmful to children under the age of 5. Every 2 minutes, malaria kills one child under 5. While that's a heavy stat to think about, there have been significant steps towards eradicating malaria. In 2016, the WHO identified 21 countries that have the potential to eradicating malaria by 2020. If you're watching this now in 2020, you know that we haven't reached that goal yet. When we talk about eradicating a disease, we're talking about reducing the number to zero or as low as possible within a defined geographic area. When we talk about elimination, we're talking about the complete erasure of the disease from all across the world. And there's only one disease that we have accomplished in eliminating: smallpox. So far, 9 countries are on track to eradicating malaria. 2 countries are certified as malaria-free, and 8 are off track, meaning that malaria continues to pose a pretty significant threat.
In the 21st century, the global health strategy still involves some of those historically effective measures like vector control, but there is a vaccine, specifically a vaccine developed against Plasmodium falciparum, since that's the most dangerous version of the parasite for humans. Back in January of 2016, the WHO recommended introducing a vaccine called RTSS into 3 African countries: Ghana, Kenya, and Malawi. Children in those areas would get their first dose somewhere around 5 to 6 months old, then a few more doses in the months after that. This vaccine works in that small window between mosquito bite and liver invasion. And as of today, RTSS is the only approved vaccine for malaria, although more are being investigated. One of the promising vaccine candidates, RH5, uses a different attack route. It goes after the parasite while it's in the blood. This drug is still in phase 1 and phase 2 trials. And like I said before, RTSS is the only vaccine, as of today, that's been approved for malaria. And this vaccine is in addition to all the other things we can throw at malaria, from medications like chloroquine to strategies like mosquito nets and draining standing water and all the other prevention strategies. The point of telling you this story was to highlight that there was no single eureka moment. It was a congregation of all these little strategies that have added up to such monumental progress. If you like these kind of big picture global health topics, I'm gonna recommend Susanna's podcast, Global Caveat, where she and Diana Klatt talk about different topics within global health. They have all kinds of interesting guests on. Highly recommend it. Check out these two right here. Otherwise, if you like more medical history stuff, you can check out this playlist right here. Subscribe right here. Of course, always, thank you for watching. Have fun, be good, wash your hands.